Once upon a time, there was a myth. I'm not sure if anyone still believes it, but supposedly if the Earth were a meter closer to the sun, we would burn, and if it were a meter further, we would freeze. Our planet gets closer and further from the sun by a whopping 4.5 million kilometers within a year. Even if you were to add or subtract a kilometer, let alone a meter, life would continue uninterrupted. But there's more. Forget about moving closer or further from the sun. Even if the sun were to disappear instantly, life could continue for billions of years. I'll even go further. Ejecting Earth from the sun's orbit might be something we have to do at some point. Why am I saying that? Gather round. The sun was born 4.6 billion years ago. Its mass, 333,000 times that of Earth, started to collapse on itself due to gravitational force. However, like in all stars, the enormous temperatures created by the friction and pressure during this collapse caused the hydrogen atoms, which make up 91% of the sun, to begin fusing, having stripped their surrounding electrons and pushed them into the realm of the strong nuclear force within a femtometer's range. This was the birth of fusion. These fusing hydrogen atoms began to turn into helium, and this process released enormous amounts of energy for reasons we have seen before. This energy managed to balance out our star, trying to collapse onto itself, and to this day, this energy generated by fusion provides Earth with a vital energy source. We say vital energy source, but would there have been no life on Earth without the sun? In fact, the sun only has one importance for the beginning of life on Earth. It provides the heat that allows water to remain liquid. That's not everywhere, of course. There's a zone we call the Goldilocks zone around every star. In this zone, water can be liquid on celestial bodies. However, for this to happen, there also needs to be sufficient atmospheric pressure on the planet's surface. Otherwise, the sun can't ensure this just by providing energy. The Goldilocks zone for the sun starts around 38% of the distance between the Earth and the sun and continues up to 10 times the Earth's orbit. We'll get into why water is so vital for life in another video. But the critical point is this. Even if we were to assume that life couldn't exist without liquid water, a planet or moon could still have liquid water without a sun. For example, we've discussed before life on Earth began at hydrothermal vents at the bottom of the oceans. These vents are hotter than the surface of the Earth. That's because the sun isn't the only source of heat on our planet. The Earth's core layer is also a tremendous source of heat. This heat reaches the surface through magma and keeps the water there at a habitable temperature and in liquid form. So when life began on Earth, we didn't need the sun. In fact, we weren't even aware of its existence somewhere out there. But is this valid for today? After all, we all survive by breathing the oxygen that plants and especially algae produce thanks to the sun. Could life without the sun be possible? Indeed, what would happen if the sun suddenly disappeared? First off, we need to grasp that no force in the universe can have instantaneous effect. We perceive gravity as if it acts instantly, but don't forget that nothing in the universe can exceed the speed of light, gravity included. So, if we were to erase the sun in a snap, it would take exactly 8 minutes and 20 seconds for the Earth to notice this disappearance. This is because it takes that long for light and gravitational waves emitted from the sun to reach us. This is indeed a mind-bending concept. Suppose the sun simply vanished. For the next 8 minutes and 20 seconds, we, the inhabitants of Earth, would continue to see the sun and spin along its orbit for a full distance of about 15,000 kilometers. Out there at Pluto and beyond, it would take hours, even days, to notice this disappearance. They would keep spinning as if nothing happened, orbiting a sun that no longer existed. However, when the gravitational waves from the sun's disappearance finally hit us, the sun we see in the sky would vanish instantly. And at that moment, the Earth, wherever it is in its orbit, would stop following an elliptical path and instead would be hurled straight into the vastness of space. And we wouldn't even notice this jolt. The most apparent consequence of the sun's disappearance would be the instantaneous plunge into darkness. As we have seen in the moon video, without sunlight to reflect off the moon, our nights would become about 10 times darker than they are during a new moon. Our planet currently with an average temperature around 14 or 15 degrees Celsius would rapidly start cooling down. The speed of this cooling would depend on how heat transfer operates under changing Earth conditions. However, in the worst case scenario, the average temperature would drop to 0 degrees in just 38 days. 83 days later, it would have fallen to negative 17 degrees. For comparison, the December average temperature in Yakutsk A city in Russia with a population of about 300,000 hovers around negative 40 degrees. The record low is roughly negative 64 degrees. In a slightly better scenario, reaching an average temperature of 0 degrees would take around 400 days, and getting to negative 17 degrees would take around 879 days. So in any case, within a few months to a few years, the Earth would turn into a snowball. The first living organisms to face the impact of this temperature and light shock would be the plants. With the disappearance of the sun, the process of photosynthesis would also cease, so they would only be able to survive as long as their starch reserves last. Very large trees could survive for 2 to 3 months, but many small plants would die within a few days. Naturally, you can imagine how this would shake up the food chain. With the death of the plants, you might think the main problem would be oxygen production, but no, our atmosphere currently contains 1.2 quintillion kilograms of oxygen. A single human consumes around 840 grams of oxygen a day. So if only humans were consuming oxygen, we would have oxygen to consume for about 500,000 years. This is 1.5 times the duration our species has been around since its evolution. Other organisms also consume oxygen, but as the plants begin to die, the herbivores will starve. And as the herbivores die off, the carnivores will start to fall, eliminating many species. Therefore, their impact on oxygen would be somewhat less. Also, since all this destruction would happen very quickly, there may not be enough time for evolution to kick in. This would trigger a tremendous extinction. But life is not just about animals and plants. The estimated 8.7 million eukaryotes on Earth are nothing compared to bacteria and archaea. Almost none of these single-celled organisms need photosynthesis, plants, animals, or anything like that. Every complex life form that we think of when we talk about life evolved from ancestors similar to these simple bacteria. So as long as bacteria and archaea survive, life could diversify again. Indeed, many bacteria and archaea have evolved to survive in the most extreme temperatures, cold, salt, and acid conditions. So millions of species on Earth would continue their existence regardless of whether the sun exists or not. Life would find a way and continue to exist on Earth for billions, not thousands or millions of years. What about us humans? Could we survive? Could our civilization survive? Frankly, probably yes. It depends on how prepared we are for such a crisis. For example, our livestock and fields would disappear due to the disruption of the food chain, and everything would change for us too. It would be impossible to feed 8 billion people, and a large portion of humanity would disappear. However, some of us could survive by producing synthetic foods. With artificial lighting, we could continue to locally produce plants. Also, ironically, fossil fuels and nuclear energy would become our greatest allies. And fossil fuels would support our civilization for thousands of years, nuclear energy for billions. Although even then, we would have to be careful with fossil fuels, because fossil fuels consume 1,000 tons of oxygen each second. In a world without plants, we couldn't afford to burn oxygen recklessly. But of course, the human population would decrease rapidly, so we wouldn't need to consume as much fuel. Of course, the level of our civilization at the time of such an event, which is not very likely according to the laws of physics, like the disappearance of the sun, also affects how it would impact us. If we're caught by such a disaster with an immature and poor energy and supply network like today, probably many of us would perish. But if we reached a type 2 or 3 civilization when this catastrophe occurred, we could easily move to another planet, we could terraform it, in other words, we could make it Earth-like. And we could take some of the life with us and write a modern-day Noah's Ark story. Even if we don't have such an advanced civilization and space program, if we're a bit prepared for this kind of catastrophe, we could start building massive underground cities in no time. Because long, long before the oxygen would deplete due to being breathed in, the Earth's surface temperature would hit minus 96 degrees. And at that temperature, the air we breathe would begin to liquefy. Therefore, we would start having trouble finding gaseous oxygen on the surface. Hence, we would need to create environments where the air wouldn't liquefy. The deeper we go into the ground, the higher the temperatures get. Take, for instance, the gold mine in South Africa, 4 kilometers deep and 66 degrees hot. So we don't even need to go that deep. In the cities that we would build a few kilometers below the ground, we could establish an entirely new civilization. Who knows, maybe this time we could even establish a slightly more humane and inclusive order, and we don't necessarily need the sun to disappear to abandon this system. Like I said, one day we might need to distance ourselves from the sun anyway. As I initially explained, the energy released during the transformation of hydrogen into helium results in the sun slowly losing mass. Because remember, E equals mc squared. To radiate energy means to lose mass. But this is an incredibly slow process. For example, in the past 4.5 billion years, our star has lost only 95 Earth masses worth of mass and energy. Therefore, it would be normal for you to assume that the remaining 333,000 Earth masses will carry it forever. But unfortunately, things don't work that way. As hydrogen turns into helium, gravitational pull increases due to a denser mass forming at the center. And the sun's core has, for this reason, been increasingly compressing and heating up since its birth. This temperature and pressure are gradually accelerating fusion, and thus the sun will become hotter and brighter with each passing year. As these temperatures increase over time, that habitable Goldilocks zone will gradually expand. But since the Earth's orbit won't change much, we will be left outside the habitable zone, and about 1 billion years from now, the world's oceans will evaporate due to extreme heat. As water from the oceans fills the atmosphere, the greenhouse gas effect will exponentially increase, and our pale blue dot will finally turn into a barren yellow desert. After a point, high-energy particles coming from space will decompose the water accumulated in the atmosphere into hydrogen and oxygen, and these gases escaping into space will cause the complete disappearance of water on Earth. Let's say we manage to get through this. About 3.5 to 4 billion years later, we will reach the end of the sun's life as we know it. By that point, the hydrogen in the sun's core, which contains 12% of all the hydrogen in the sun, will have been exhausted. Once all the hydrogen in the core has turned into helium, gravitational pull will further shrink the core, and the hydrogen in the radiative zone just outside the core will begin to fuse. The fusion in this intermediate layer will push the outer layers outward, causing the sun to grow large enough to swallow Mercury and expand to Venus's orbit. But at this point, the sun's core will reach 100 million degrees and start helium fusion. Thus, helium atoms in the sun will begin to fuse together to create larger elements such as carbon and oxygen. This process will reduce the pressure in the sun's outer layers, and the gravitational pull at the center will cause the sun to shrink again. As the helium fusion in the core continues, the core will collapse further due to increasing gravitational pull and once again trigger fusion in the outer layers, causing the sun to grow. There is expected to be about 100 million years between these two growth periods. However, in the second growth, the sun will swallow Venus and its boundaries will extend to the Earth's orbit. At this point, we don't know for sure whether it will swallow Earth or not. Because as the sun goes through these cycles of inflation and deflation, it'll struggle to hold onto its outer layers. These will be cast off into space, forming what we refer to as a planetary nebula. This means a decrease in the sun's mass. And as the sun loses mass, its gravitational pull on Earth and the other planets will lessen. Consequently, our orbit will begin to expand and we'll start to drift away from the sun. So there's a chance that our planet could be spared from being engulfed thanks to this orbital expansion. The dynamics of all these processes are highly variable, making it tough to say anything with certainty right now. However, even if the sun doesn't end up swallowing Earth due to its extreme brightness and heat, our planet's water and atmosphere will inevitably evaporate, just as previously explained. If the sun truly ends up engulfing our planet, the rocks on Earth will also evaporate over hundreds of millions of years, and Earth and everything on it will be forever obliterated. That's why even if we manage to withstand all the threats like global warming that are currently endangering humanity, we can only survive on this planet for at most another 1 billion years. As I mentioned earlier, we've only been on Earth for around 300,000 years. However, life has existed for 4 billion years. This means we only have about 25% of the total existence of the planet left. If we keep sitting idly by, our sun will ultimately destroy us. Hence, in the long run, we have two choices. Either we evolve into an intergalactic civilization and migrate from these lands, or we initiate a grand plan, as life on Earth could potentially continue even in much harsher conditions than we currently face. And even without the sun, instead of fragmentally transferring it to other galaxies to preserve it, we could transform Earth into a gigantic spaceship and eject it from the sun's orbit. I know this currently sounds like an absurd science fiction scenario, but if we manage to avoid extinction by then, we'll have to do something, whether we like it or not. See you in the next video. Stay safe.